Good morning. It is so good to see so many of you. Welcome in the name of the Lord Jesus. Delighted to have you here in the house. Good to see guests with us as well. Some of you for the first time, some for the first time in a long time, some for the second and third time. We're just delighted to have you here. And again, we say welcome to those who are viewing online. We are broadcasting through Facebook Live right now. And so we welcome you as well and just encourage you. Be sure to like, to share, and do all those things in social media that you're supposed to do, which I typically don't know how to do. But anyway, I know that you do. And we want to welcome you as we get ready to launch God's Word today. And so thank you, Leah, for such a good job of getting us ready for the Word of God, for what a good time of worship we had. I love that last song as we just begin to declare His name and to just declare who He is, which really leads into the message that I have for you this morning. We've been talking about the parables of Jesus now for 8 weeks. You know, whenever I do an 8 week sermon, usually by the 8th week I see deer in the headlights. It's like, is there anything else in the Bible? And I usually say, yeah, when you start living what we've been preaching, we'll go to the next subject. But anyway, we want to preach the Word of God, the counsel of God's Word. And Jesus, as we learned, used parables. They're stories in which He did several things. One, He would highlight insights that we needed to know about the kingdom of heaven. He had come down from heaven. No one else had been there, so He was able to share with us how the kingdom of heaven functions and His expectations of us as we move forward. He also drew clear contrast between the way the world saw God and the way God wanted to be seen, and how we serve and love Him, and how we indeed at that time, and how we should love Him. We looked at the parable of the soil in the first week, and in that parable we talked about, and this was at a moment when our communities were kind of erupting and social unrest and all kind of things was going on, and of course many people wanted, you know, pastor, preach a message about, quote unquote, you know. But here's the thing, we started talking about our heart, because no matter what the issue of the day is, if our heart is not right with God, we will never stand on God's side. Just because it's the daily issue. And listen, there's some important issues being discussed today, and we need to be in that discussion. But listen, we need to do it from God's point of view, not from our own point of view, or from our emotions, or from guilt, or from whatever the news is saying. Can you say amen or oh me or something about that? Anyway, we talked about the parables of the soil and the different conditions of our heart and the necessity of our heart being ready to hear, receive, and produce the fruit of the Spirit in our lives. Then we talked about the unforgiving servant and how apropos that was for the moment, that no matter how many times someone sins against me, we've got to learn how to forgive. God made a way. He showed us an example, and that in fact, if we do not distribute that forgiveness, if we don't be an example of forgiveness, then we will not even be able to appreciate and enjoy that forgiveness ourselves. The next week we talked about the lost son and how God brings us back. We talked about racism in that particular message and how there is a call from God to be reconciled with one another. We talked about the Good Samaritan. We talked about the lost sheep and how God cares for the flock. We talked about the talents and how God wants us to invest our lives in such a way that the kingdom of God advances not only in us, but through us to others. Last week, Pastor Bob was here, and he shared with us about the faithful servant and about how, you know, a moment can pass so quickly and we not even realize that that was the defining moment of our lives. And today, in the last message in this series, I want to talk to you about the great banquet that Jesus spoke of in Matthew chapter 22. In effect, he actually did start talking about it all the way in Genesis and brought it all the way through. But we're going to look at Genesis chapter 22. And as we look at this, it's important for us to remember and to understand that Jesus kept saying this to people. He kept saying, let him who has ears hear. Now, it wasn't that they didn't have ears on the side of their heads, and it wasn't that they weren't hearing his words, but it goes back to that first parable of the soil, that their heart was so often filled with other things that the word was like seed falling on in unprepared soil. So today I want to invite you, because I want to tell you, this is going to get rubber is going to meet the road, as someone used to say, J. Vernon McGee. This is where the rubber meets the road. This is going to be, for you and I, a real challenge, I think, in places. And I hope that it will bring some insight and some encouragement to your heart as well. But I want us to understand that not all who heard, accepted, and believed. And in this message today, in this parable, in fact, we're going to talk about even those in the church or those who had responded to Christ's invitation, not all actually heard and not all actually believed. So I want to read to you from Matthew 22, verses 1 through 14. I'm going to read it quickly, but I'm going to read it, and then I'm going to go back and unpack that if it's okay. So Matthew chapter 22, verses 1 through 14. Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like." This is a similitude. This is what it's like. You've never been there. I've been there. This is what it's like. "A king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son, and he sent out his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Well, then he sent out more servants and said to them, 'Tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen, my fattened cattle have been butchered and are being roasted, and everything is prepared and ready.'" Now, I'm just going to just pause right there, interrupt myself to tell you that any time you put a feed on where you're barbecuing anything, I don't care if it's chicken, I don't care if it's cows, I don't care if it's pork, I do care if it's frog legs. I probably won't show up for frog legs, but most anything else, I'm for barbecue. So just be aware. He says, "Listen, everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet." But they paid no attention again, and they went off, one to his field and another to his business. They were too busy to participate in what the king was doing. The rest seized his servants and even mistreated them and killed them. And the king then was enraged, and he sent his army and destroyed and those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. So go now to the streets, to the corners, and invite to the banquet anyone you find.' So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, the bad as well as the good, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. Then the king told the... Oh, I'm sorry. But then when the king came in, he came in to see the guests. He noticed a man who was there not wearing wedding clothes, and he asked, 'How did you get in here without wearing wedding garments?'" Now, you know, we're kind of a casual society, but in this particular setting and in most of the Eastern settings, I've been to many Eastern weddings, and you don't go without wearing the proper attire. You stand out and you are ushered out. You've got to have the tie, the whole thing. They call it the costume. "How did you get in here without wearing the proper attire, friend?" And the man was speechless. Then the king told his attendants, "Tie this man up hand and foot and throw him outside into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are invited." Many are called, it says in another translation, but few are chosen. Now this is a key parable, and Jesus wants his hearers to understand several important issues about the kingdom of God. In particular, he wants to warn them regarding things to come. He wants this to understand that this message is for everyone, those who have responded, those who are part of his family, all need to hear. One, hear this invitation, but two, understand that this invitation has with it certain prerequisites or certain qualifications that we need to follow. In this particular message, he begins as he's warning about things to come. It's actually a series of sermonettes or parables or stories that he begins to share that kind of frame, that do frame the church's eschatology. Eschatology is the doctrine of last things, what will happen in the end. And I want to unpack this for you today, but I don't want you to think that I'm going to start interpreting the signs of the times. Oh, pastor's going to tell us now who the Antichrist is. I wish I knew, but if I did, I wouldn't utter a word about it. I wouldn't write a book. You wouldn't be able to get all that information out of me. That has not been revealed to me, nor do I think the pandemic that we're in, and it's serious. But it's not the first pandemic. Let me say that again. It's not the first pandemic. In fact, since they've been recording history, there have been pandemic after pandemic after pandemic. In the first century, there was a pandemic that wiped out 10 million people in one geographic area. That was followed by the great plagues. Do you remember the great plague, the Black Death, they called it, in started in the 3rd century, then again in the 5th century, then again in the 8th century, then again in the 10th century. It went even up to the 15th century and killed over 75% of those living in Europe during that time. This is not the first pandemic. This is not God's first emergency cry from his people. Now, I say that not to belittle the moment that we're in, but to help you understand that the moment that we're in calls our attention to our mortality, but does not necessarily signal that Jesus is about to burst through the clouds. He could. Don't misunderstand me. But I want you to understand, the pandemic certainly is the sign that Jesus is about to come. The sign that Jesus is about to come is simply this: watch and be ready, because you know not the hour nor the day. Nor is it, the social unrest that we see in our nation right now. And listen, again, people have said, why haven't you talked more about this? Why haven't you taken a side? Why aren't you talking about Black Lives Matter or Red Lives Matter or Green Lives or All Lives? Listen, number one, I just don't run after everything that people start talking about. I don't react and respond to everything that's in the news. Well, I do emotionally and in prayer, but it doesn't find its place here unless I see that God clearly is speaking to us. And I believe he is speaking to us, again, about the issues of our heart, and that we, the church, have not done a good enough job in the areas of racial reconciliation and being a leader in breaking down barriers and lifting the oppressed, lifting the burden of every man and woman and child. But that's something we can do, and we must do. By the grace of God, we've always been, or for the most part, always been a church that's been integrated, and we've had young people and old people, and we've had boys and girls, and we've had, every nationality that under the sun, and every different hue of person attends this congregation. Many who speak English as a second language, and some even as a third, and some not yet so much. But it doesn't matter about that. Our hearts need to be right, one with God, and then they'll be right with one another. Can you say amen? And so, as I unpack this, don't expect that, but I do want you to hear that Jesus is talking about the end of all things. And I want you to also understand that as I talk about this, that we all ultimately face a day, a last day. That day may come when my body is separated from my spirit in death, as I've had the sad privilege of walking with several individuals, and even now walking with a dear friend through his last days based on medical determination, but of course God is the one that determines our last moments. So we all are going to face this either by death or by the shout of the Lord, and when he bursts through and changes everything and ushers his kingdom here onto the earth. So let me take just a moment to unpack this story for you, first by introducing those primary characters that Jesus has used, and then we'll run through this story, not too quickly, but we want to pull the marrow and get the marrow out of the bones. So let's talk about the characters. First of all, Jesus says there is a king, and that king, of course, is referring to God the Father, the creator of all things. Secondly, the king is giving a party, a wedding feast for his son. And that son, of course, refers to the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Jesus refers to the king's servants. And we need to think about the reality of that, which is that the king's servants are those who spoke and who said, "The Lord is coming." So we would have to go all the way back to Adam and Eve. We'd have to go all the way back, especially to Moses and the law and the prophets, who all claimed or projected and prophesied that the Messiah would one day come and was calling us back to a proper relationship with God. Yet man resisted that. We have to think about Jesus, who himself ushered the invitation, "Come unto me, all you who are weary." We have to think of the apostles and even those of us, as myself and many of you, who have been called and who have made a purpose of our life to proclaim the gospel. There's also two different sets of guests here. There are the Jews, those that were determined all the way back in the beginning of Genesis and revealed in Genesis chapter 3 when, Genesis chapter 15, verse 3, when God said to Abraham, "I'm going to bless you and make you a people, and all the nations shall be blessed through you." And then we see that there is a moment in time where God opens the door and says, "Okay, I'm setting this aside and I'm going to do a new thing." And yet it's not new, because from the very beginning of his moment of creation, he had planned and determined that he would have a people to worship him and praise him in the earth. So let me unpack this for you, and I'll read quickly, but then unpack it. We've already read the passage once. So Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son." So keep that context in mind. "He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused. Then I heard..." Now, I want you to think about this wedding banquet, and I want to look at the end of the book, as a matter of fact. In Revelations chapter 19, this is what the scripture says. He declares, "Then I heard what sounded like a great multitude, like a roar of rushing waters, and like a loud peals of thunder and shouting." People shouting, masses shouting, people, another verse says, a number of people that could not be numbered shouting, "Hallelujah, for our Lord God Almighty reigns. Let us then rejoice and be glad and give him glory." I tell you, that's when I get excited. When we start worshiping God and we begin declaring, look, there are a lot of songs that I love, but when the worship moves to magnifying him and focuses just on him and lets everything else lay it aside. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's about him. And we lift our voice and we begin declaring his goodness and glory. It just excites me, because that is the mission. That is the message that you and I have. "For the wedding of the Lamb," it says, "has come, and his bride has made herself ready." The bride is the church, those who have been called out and called unto him. "And they've been clothed in fine linen, bright and clean was given to her to wear." Revelations 19, verses 6 through 8. There is a moment in time coming when this parable becomes a reality, and you and I must be aware and prepared for that. Reading on in Matthew, he goes on to say, "Then he sent more servants and said, 'Tell those who have been invited and I have prepared, that I've prepared my dinner, everything's ready, tell them to come to the wedding banquet.' But again, they refused." Now, there are probably many more, but there are five important lessons that I just want to touch on as we go through this passage. First of all, Jesus tells us that God invited all of us. He invited us to the messianic, to the wedding feast that would celebrate his son. This parable tells us that he began with the Jews, and I've told you this before, and I wish I had time to unpack it all, but God chose the children of Abraham, not because they were Jews, but because they were children of faith, to be God's ambassadors to the world, to be the ones that would deliver the message, the king is coming. To be the ones that, like Solomon, people would go to and ask the questions and get the answers about life and about eternity. But because they shifted, God responded. Paul says this in Romans. He says, listen, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, and I preach the gospel because it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, first to the Jew, but then also to the Gentiles. Anyone who believes, I am delighted to share this gospel message. But Jesus wants us to understand that first, the message was spoken to the Jewish people. But look, as Jesus continues this verse, he says, but when they paid no attention and went off to their fields, one to his business and another to his field, and the rest seized his servants and killed them. Jesus wants us to see that this first invitation, since it was rejected, was followed by a second invitation, and they rejected that one also. Jesus giving us a prophetic word to show what would happen even when the Spirit came down upon the apostles, and the apostles went out and began preaching to the Gentiles. They began preaching to the house of Israel. But once again, not only did they reject them, but they seized them and they martyred them until finally the message went out in Acts chapter 10, began going to all the nations of the earth. When God declared that he had made even the Gentiles acceptable to him. And the king being enraged, he sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their cities in 70 AD. That's exactly what happened. The entire city of Jerusalem was sieged and the temple was torn down almost stone by stone. It was really a judgment of God upon the nation for them turning their back. Not a judgment that he would never respond to them, but a judgment on their actions of rejection. There's an important lesson. And you know, if we've been reading, through the Bible together in 1 Kings and 2 Kings, even in as we read through 1 and 2 Samuel and saw how Israel would follow God and then the next leader would not follow God, and they were up and down and up and down and into idolatry. More times it seems they were in idolatry than they were serving God with the whole heart. It reminds us of what Jim Croce said back in the 70s. Many of you weren't even born in the 70s, but he wrote this amazing song. He said this, and you could write this down and probably memorize it. Most of you, some of you may even know it. He says, number one, you don't tug on Superman's cape. You don't spit into the wind. You don't pull the mask off the old Long Ranger, and you don't mess around with God. Now, I added the second part. But sometimes we think we can get by with living life at our own measure, by our own decision or morality based on our own likes or dislikes. Does that make sense? We think we can treat God as if he has no real claim to our life or to our world. But that's just not true. You don't play with God. If you read the Old Testament, someone asked me one time, and I say this all the time to you, the reason God writes and records the good, the bad, the ugly about those kings. I mean, David, who was an amazing worshiper and knew God and heart was after God and killed Goliath and did all this wonderful stuff, was so moved by his own flesh and lust that he committed adultery, conspired to commit murder, covered it all up, and all these things. He records both the good, the bad, the ugly. I like to say he records the story, warts and all. Why does he do that? Because he wants you to know that even though there is something in us searching after God, there's always that propensity that will reject God, and we need to be aware of it. You see, but our culture, the culture in which we live, a culture which I'm a part of and have over the years undoubtedly fed into, we've in some ways emasculated God. We've taken away from him. his, or at least we have suggested that he lacks the ability or that he will never punish. I think that's partly in response to our betrayal or the betrayal that I heard, and maybe as a kid grew up under this fear of God, that he was just waiting to throw a lightning bolt at me, that he was some kind of angry being sitting on, you know, up on his porch, just waiting for me to mess up so he could strike me with cancer or some other disease. And I don't think that's actually correct at all, but I do know this, that in our attempt to portray God as a happy God, as a loving God, as a merciful God, in some ways we have removed his ability, the teeth of God's law, to bring on us repentance. Boy, I don't know if that was I couldn't tell if that was an approval or a sigh, but it's true. We have betrayed him now more as a jovial, good-natured, benevolent being, incapable of wrath and anger, too laid back to take our sin seriously, more subdued, more understanding, frankly, afraid to offend anyone, lest they would think bad of him. Brothers, sisters, men, women, boys, girls, that's not the God we serve. God is a holy God. In fact, let me go so far as to say that is stinking thinking and rotten theology, and I repent to God for any part I've played in that. We've learned through reading the Bible that God holds his people accountable, and God does not wink at sin. Now, that's not to say that God does not love us. God does love us. His love for us, though, is only possible because, let me put it this way, our experience of his love is only possible because he poured out his anger and wrath against the Lord Jesus Christ in our place, who obediently and willingly accepted our sentence. But you see, we mistake delayed judgment for divine indifference. And that's a mistake. That's a sin. And it's a sin that I don't want us to be guilty of. I don't want to be guilty of. And I want to understand that Jesus was speaking this parable not just to the Jews who would at that moment reject him, but also those who would come when he said, "Many are called, but few are chosen." I don't want you to be called just into the doors of the church. I want you to be engrafted into the vine himself, producing that life-giving fruit. Paul points out in Romans chapter 9, verse 22, that God is slow to anger, and he chooses to demonstrate great patience on the disobedient that ultimately would become the subjects of his wrath. But this patience or long-suffering, he says, this delayed judgment is a demonstration of God's mercy, not divine impotency. In fact, if you want to know, justice is getting what I deserve. But Jesus bore God's justice for you and for me. Jesus took upon himself my justice, because the Bible says in Romans 3:23, and you know this verse, that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and that it goes on in Romans 6:23 to say that the wages of our sin, that which we have earned, is not a pat on the back, but our lives have accumulated a justice of God's wrath. The wages of sin is death. Make no mistake, death is in the world because of sin. And death will take its toll on all of us should the Lord tarry. But it cannot eternally separate us from God. But we've not been appointed unto that wrath. We've been appointed unto his mercy. And mercy is this: not getting what I deserve. Paul says again in Romans chapter 2, he says, do not show contempt for the riches of his kindness, for the forbearance and patience, not realizing God's kindness. His mercy is intended to lead us unto repentance, to turn us around. Why? Because only because of Jesus do you get the grace of God, which is getting what you do not deserve. but rather getting what Jesus deserves. But his warning for us should not be missed. Grace has its boundaries. It has its limitations. But I thought you told us it was unmerited. I thought you told us it was boundless. Yes, it is. Grace is freely given unto us, but it's given unto us in response to the gift of faith. When we embrace faith and respond to him, it is given to us freely. Grace, we get not what we deserve, but what he deserves as we respond to him. But let me just tell you, there are many under the sound of my voice right now, not only in this room, but maybe at home in your living room, that has heard this message over and over, and through your good works, through your moral obedience, feel like you've justified yourself before God, or you've bought into one of those new doctrines. Maybe it's universalism. All roads lead to God. I don't have to accept Jesus. I don't have to follow that way. Everybody gets into heaven. That's ultimate reconciliationist, that God wouldn't condemn anyone to die. Doesn't the Bible say he died for all the sins, for God so loved the world that he died for all? Yes, it says that, but there's a condition, and that condition is a response of faith. You see, faith allows God to impute to us, to place on us this grace, this gift, but it's not given willy-nilly. I know sometimes when at the close of this sermon, and I will in just a few moments lead us all in a prayer, and it'll seem that prayer so simple that maybe it's too simple, and there has to be more to salvation than that. And believe me, there is. There's so much behind the prayer that was done before you ever prayed the prayer. The fact that you're here, the fact that you can pray the prayer is a gift of grace and faith and God enabling you to believe. God's saying, in fact, the wedding banquet is ready. All come. Anyone who come. Everyone can come. And so this message of Jesus, this parable, teaches us also that God, listen, God's retribution was passed on to the Jews during that period of time so that you and I might become part of the family. In Romans 11, Paul says that they hardened their heart, and God even sent upon them a spirit of stupor so that their eyes could not see nor their ears hear, and they could not respond. And even to this very day, he says, they're having a struggle with it. And over the centuries, it's been exceedingly difficult to communicate the good news of Jesus Christ to many who were born in the household of Abraham because of this spirit of stupor. But let me tell you something. I'm not espousing a replacement theology at the moment. I'm not telling you that God never loved Israel or that God never will love them again and he only loves you. No, I'm telling you that, listen, be aware, those that were born heirs to this promise because of their attitude and because of their rejection got set aside, and by grace you were added to that number. By grace you went around them. They were called by God, determined by God to be his ambassadors to the world. He said, you are kings and priests through the law, and I have made you to be a people of illumination, and you will be my messengers. People will come to you and say, why are you different? Tell us about your God. But because they rejected that, because they embraced other gods, because they culturized God so they could control him, he stepped back, pulled his grace, and fulfilled his plan. It wasn't because he woke up one day and said, I got to do something, this isn't working. No, his plan was from the beginning of Genesis, when he created Adam and Eve, that he would have a people in the earth that would love him, that would be called according to his name, that would worship him in holiness and in the spirit of truth. And listen, he never lost sight of that. And throughout the Old Testament, we see him declaring that he will have a people of every tribe, tongue, and nation. And you and I are part of that. We've been called in. But understand, if God, who set aside the children of Israel for a season so that you and I might be grafted in because of their disobedience, you and I need to be aware and understand that we have a responsibility as believers too. That it's not, oh, baptize me, give me a certificate, I'll put it on the wall, I'll put it in the family Bible, and I'm in like Flynn, and nobody can mess with me. I believe in the perseverance of believers. I believe that no one can snatch you out of the hand of God. I believe with all my heart that when you come to Him by faith, you are eternally born again, that your sins, past, present, future, have been atoned for. But there's still a walking into the revelation in being obedient and receiving the reward of His sons and daughters. And you and I have been called to that. Clearly in my mind, I preach much faster on paper than I do in person. Aren't you glad? I know every time I hand my packet of notes, my manuscript to Crystal, she looks at the 15 to 20 pages and she's like, right. Dear Jesus, please don't let him say all this. She intercedes for you to deliver you. And someone said, Crystal, pray harder. Anyway, okay. I think it's so important that we recognize that God has a people. God has a plan. His message to the earth was, come unto me, all of you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. That was His message, and that was the message that the disciples would later espouse. It's the message that today we espouse. We believe that, as it says in Romans chapter 4, verse 5, Romans so full of theology regarding salvation, understanding our righteousness, which is found in Him. He says that God has for Himself a people of every tribe, kindred, tongue, and nation, every one of them, including those who we would consider ungodly and unworthy and unacceptable. And this parable makes clear and important that He is going to go and He is going to receive unto Himself into the church people that we would not necessarily recognize as being the right ones. But just as we came in, we and they are offered the opportunity to be clothed in robes of righteousness given to us by the very blood of Jesus Christ. I love the old hymn. We don't sing old hymns very much anymore, partly because these newfangled worship leaders, where's she at? They don't know the old hymns like the good old. But there's just one hymn that says, I have no hope of getting to heaven but by the blood of Jesus. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and His righteousness. Listen, there are those in the church who, I'm just going to be honest with you, there are those in the church who've been in the church, in this church, since I've been here. And I'm not looking and saying, I know you and I know you, but I fear, I believe, just because I understand the Word of God and people, the nature of people, that there are people who say, oh, I'm a member of, and they name the organization or the group that they're a part of, that they identify with, that's my tradition, and yet they really have not had a life-changing transformation that took place by faith in Jesus Christ. They've not surrendered to the total lordship of Jesus. And I just really need to say to you, my friends, that this parable alerts us to the fact that we may be sitting here, and as He said in Matthew chapter 7, we may be singing, Lord, Lord, remember when I passed out chicken in Your name? Remember when I prayed for people as they came through the line and we gave them boxes of food? Lord, remember when I helped cook and we fed the homeless? Remember when I went and we took clothing and we gave it to those who were in need? Remember when I went to the hospital and did all these things? And I did it for You, Lord. And He says to those, and I don't want to be one of those, and I'm convinced I won't be, because my heart convicts me that I should be this one who is surrendered to His total lordship. But listen, here's what I want you to see. There will be those who will tell Him Listen, I went through first step, next step. I did leader step. I was a small group leader. But because they never had a personal relationship, they never surrendered to his lordship. You see, surrendering to his lordship is not about joining the church, getting dunked in water, eating the wafer and the, you know, the blood, the cup. It's not about following the rules. It's about being in relationship with him. And there Jesus looks at this one individual in his story who is not clothed properly, who's not wearing the robes of righteousness, who's not in right standing with him, not who was and then is no more. He was in the group. He was in the at the table, but he had responded to the invitation to come, but he had never surrendered to God on his terms. And he said, "Depart from me." And there'll be those who said, "I did." And he said, "But I didn't know you just because you did these things in my name." I hope that doesn't seem too harsh, but I want you to be aware and awake. It's popular today to say we're woke. I want you to be woke to this. I want you to be aware that you've been called into a relationship. And your response to God is important. The point of the story that Jesus told is that you must be ready. You must be clothed. You must have the garment of the Holy Spirit, of him resting on you and in you and working through you. You cannot be a part of the family of God without his presence convicting, converting, and controlling. That's the teaching of the Holy Spirit. The point of the story is that we should be ready. That we as believers should not become indifferent and think, "Well, I got my 401k in heaven. When it's all said and done, I'll go to heaven and that's it. It's done. I'll get up to heaven." And he said, "What did you do with the gifts I gave you?" And he said, "Well, you know, Lord, I was," and we got all these excuses. And but he's looking for a people, a church. And I believe that this is an hour when the church needs to be the light as never before. I believe this is a time when the church needs to be brighter and cleaner and more aware than ever before, shining, being his ambassadors. I don't want to be the church that got passed over and God had to raise up another church. Yes, Lord, raise up other churches in our community, but Lord, don't pass me by. Pass me not, O gentle Savior. I want you and I want I to be ambassadors of his love, mercy, his light in such a way that others can find their way in the darkness, find hope in the hopelessness, in the confusion, and can find true peace and assurance that my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. It's one of the reasons that we talk about, we push, we offer our growth track. In fact, today there'll be Pastor Jacob will be outside and he'll be inviting you to join the first step. If you've never been through the first step, you might say, "Yeah, but I've been in church for 30 years. I don't care. I don't care." You could say, "Look, I've got a master's degree. I've got a doctorate degree. I've got this degree. I don't care. The church is dying by degrees. I got a bunch of them." And I can tell you that at the end of the day, nobody even cares. Nobody even cares. They're not worth the paper I have to pay that they were written on. Here's the thing. I want you to know that you know that you know that you are surrendered and living in a relationship with your Lord. And so I want to invite you, if you've not been through First Step, join. If you've not been through Next Step, these are small groups. Next Step, I want you to sign up and become a part. I want to help you be all that you can be. That's not the army. I want you to be all that you can be in Jesus. And so he'll make that available to you. Now, as I close, I told you, I often pray a simple prayer. I usually pray almost the same prayer every time, but this morning, and I still pray that, but I thought I should share this with you, that as I talk about this prayer, and I want you to understand that as you pray that, you're actually doing something. You're actually responding and confessing to God. You're surrendering and repenting to him. You're going through a process of accepting that gift that he is offering you with thanksgiving, and you're making a commitment to action. That's what repentance means. It means I'm going to turn from what I was doing, and I'm going to do something else. And so I want to lead you in that prayer, and I want to ask you to join me in it now. as we pray. Whether you're here in this room or you're at home in your living room or you're driving in your car and you're listening to the audio, I want to invite you to come to the wedding. If you've not been invited or if you've not made that decision, please come. If you're weary, if you're tired, if you're just absolutely exasperated with what the world's offering, now's the time to respond. Today is the day. You don't know about tomorrow. You don't know what will be happening in 36 hours. Listen, if anything, the pandemic has taught us that every day is a gift. Every time we can gather in this room together, though we're not at 100% strength and we can't all meet in one room, every time we gather, we know it's a gift from God and it is not promised. And we want to take full advantage of it to encourage one another in the Lord. So I want to invite you to join me in this prayer. The first part of it is that response. It is that confession of surrender to God. And so I want to ask you that are here in this room and you that are home, not only to listen, but join me in praying this prayer. But don't just say it for the word's sake. Say it for the word's sake, that it might enter your heart and be your declaration and confession. So let's pray it together. If you're ready to receive Christ as your Savior, if you're ready to come to the marriage supper of the Lamb to be gathered to Him, this is the prayer. Lord Jesus, say it with me, please. Lord Jesus, for too long I have kept you out of my life. I know that I am a sinner and that I cannot save myself. You see, that's my confession to Him, my response to Him. Now I'm going to surrender. But Lord, no longer will I choose to keep the door closed. I hear you knocking on my heart, and I'm asking you to come in. I'm responding by faith. You see, that's your act of acceptance. That's your act of thanksgiving. It's when you say, by faith, come on, by faith, I gratefully receive the gift of salvation. And Lord, I am ready to trust you with all of my heart, that you would be my Lord and you would be my Savior. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for coming to this earth. Now, this is our confession of faith. I believe that you are the Son of God who died on the cross for my sins and who was raised from the dead on the third day. And I thank you for hearing my prayers and for bearing my sin and for giving me the gift of eternal life. And this is the final part, which is my commitment. Simply say this: I believe your words are true. And I ask you to come into my heart, Lord Jesus, and be the Lord and Savior of my life. I will serve you forever in Jesus' name. Fill me with your Holy Spirit and empower me to be your servant. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And everyone said together, amen. Would you stand with me, please? I want to just speak God's blessing over you. I believe if you prayed that prayer, I really believe something happened in your heart. I believe something happened in the heavenlies, and by faith, you've become a recipient of this great gift of salvation. If you're listening online, if you're with us on one of our online campuses, please take a moment to send me a note at connect@manna.church. Let me know what you've done. Let me know how we can pray for you. We want to be with you. If you're in this room and you made that decision, maybe it's a recommitment, maybe it's the first time, please let me know. Let Pastor Jacob know as you depart. We want to stand with you, pray with you, and help you. Now lift your hands, because God does love you, and I love you, and it's my privilege to obey His word, and whenever we gather, to speak these words over you for Him. Now may the Lord bless you. And may the Lord keep you. And may the Lord cause His face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you and give unto you His peace, which passes all understanding. Remember, Your name has been written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You are His child, His beloved. He's called you out of the darkness into His glorious light. So as you go from this place, remember you're the head, not the tail. You're the light of the earth, and you are the salt of the world. Be ready to share what Jesus has done and is doing in you. In Jesus' name, amen. And everybody said together, amen. God bless you. I love you. Thank you for being with us this morning. God bless you. We'll see you soon.